And to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, Syndicated columnist Mark Shields, New York Times columnist David Brooks. Mark, jobs, unemployment remains the problem of this country, particularly for the people who govern it, right? I mean, it just go on and on and on.
It does, Jim, and it gets worse. We heard Ray with Mark Zandi. Mark Zandi is perhaps the most optimistic of all economists, and he acknowledged
he could barely find anything.
Exactly, he can always find some brightness, and however bleak. But I was looking 6.9 million fewer jobs today than there were in December 2007 in this country, and that's and we only had 58,000 an average a month come into the workforce, which means people just have stopped looking. I mean, we usually, by just growth, we put another 100,000 people into the workforce. So it just, I mean, it's across the board, there's no bright spots.
And you know, David, here again to pick up on what Mark Zandi said, that the key to this is confidence, that people just don't want to, they're worried, they're scared. And then he cited, again, what's happened in Washington as one of the reasons the people who have the money, in other words, these companies are making all this money, aren't hiring anybody, is they just don't trust what's going on in Washington.
Right. I think that's part of it. I think the underlying thing was described by economists Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart years ago, which is when you have a financial bubble, and which leads to a recession, is different from a normal recession. And if you look at, back at financial-led recessions, it takes a long time, 7 years or so, to get back. And in some sense, the stagnation we've seen ever since is par for the course for this kind of recession. But that doesn't mean it's not having big effects, and that doesn't mean it's not highlighting some underlying problems. And I think as this thing drags on and on, a lot of people, like in Paul's report today, are saying, well, aside from the cyclical, what's structurally wrong? And, you know, we've had an economy that's been too consumption, too little production, too much debt, too much relying on household income, too many resources and talent going to the Wall Street. We've had some serious structural problems, wage stagnation, inequality, which have not been addressed. And I think the longer this goes on, the more politicians, both of a right and left-wing variety, are going to say, we got to look at the underlying problems here, not just what are we going to do next quarter to boost job growth.
And it has been dumped on the political system, is it not, to fix this?
It has, Jim, at a time when confidence in the political system has plummeted to a new low. Right now, according to an analysis compiled by Bill McInturff, a Republican pollster, but with no partisan tilt to it at all, shows that, quoting the Washington Post survey, that 3 out of 4 people have little or no confidence that Washington can do anything to fix the economy. So as the president approaches the nation next Thursday night, he is talking to an audience that is distrustful, mistrustful, skeptical, in some cases almost cynical.
Well, what should be the expectations about what the president's going to say next Thursday night?
Well, I mean,
what are yours?
I think that what the president has to do is, I can tell you what the product of that event in that evening has to be. People have to come out. If there's a point at which Barack Obama has lost support and lost confidence, it is a sense among many of his own followers, they don't know what he really would fight for. What is that point at which he'll go into the foxhole and say, beyond this point, nothing? I mean, there was a sense that on the debt ceiling, there was never that wasn't clear. On the health care plan, there was never that clear sense of exactly where he stood, what his final principle were. We knew in general outline, but it was let the legislative process work itself. We're far beyond the legislative process working itself. It better come out of that speech like next Thursday night with a sense of, on people's part who have heard it, that, okay, I understand what has to be done. The president has convinced me of that, that we need to do it, that I am, I have a role in supporting him to do that. I mean, and that is necessary with those, and that better not be more than 3 points to it as to what has to be done.
You agree? That's a high bar.
Yeah,
David.
That is a high bar, and he hasn't done that since, but he hasn't really set out an agenda. What is the country going to look like in 2020? Here's what I'm shooting for. And I don't think he's done that. All of his speeches, he had many domestic policy speeches, it's been about a specific piece of legislation or it's been as part of a negotiating process, not really the big picture. And so what one expects from the speech is a series of modest job-producing things for the next quarter, maybe some infrastructure spending, maybe the payroll tax deduction, maybe some more green energy talk. But I don't think particularly that familiar stuff is going to influence and impress the American people. I really would go down to the fundamentals, like I said before, and say we've got some fundamental problems. Here's what government should do, which are sort of Republican ideas, maybe some clean tax reform, maybe lower the corporate tax rates. Here's what government should do, some Democratic ideas, spend more on human capital, invest on technology and stuff like that, mix it all up. And I don't think that's alien to what he stands for, but he really hasn't laid it out in any big comprehensive form.
You expect him to do that?
No, I don't. I think they'll go for, I think they're so focused, as any administration is at this point in its term, on just trying to boost jobs by Election Day. And so I think they'll focus on these smaller things.
But why, if it's such a big deal, such a major, major thing in this country, and he acknowledges it, and the whole country acknowledges it, and he's going to appear before a joint session of Congress, why do what you say he's going to do?
Well, people in their third year in office are exhausted. They're really only looking to the short term. Second, to do a big program that looks at some of the economic fundamentals, you have to mess up your base. For a Democrat, they'd have to say probably some corporate tax reduction, along with some Democratic-friendly things. For a Republican, also. To fix the deep structural problems, you have to do things from each party's column. And that's hard to do if you really want to mobilize your base.
I disagree. I think that's to be a holy cow moment. I think that I agree with David on the small things. I mean that you're going to do the unemployment extension, you're going to do the payroll tax extension. There'll be those, and there may be some other fiddling. But I think there has to be something big that is different. It can't be the cats and dogs we've heard before. I mean, once he starts talking about green jobs, and you know, there's just going to be eyes rolling. And people are going to be saying, is there arena football on the other channel? I mean, it's got to be something, whether it's FAST, which is the proposal to fix the schools in America. It's got to be labor intensive. It cannot be capital intensive. It can't be machine intensive. It's got to be jobs for people.
Let's say he did that. Let's say he did exactly what you think he should do. Would that be well received by the Republicans?
I think given what we have right now, I mean, we saw a hemorrhaging of support in this country, toward the president in the month of August and the Republicans. Republicans even worse, small consolation, cold consolation for the Democrats because of the way the debt ceiling was handled. Mm-hmm. It was not only the product that came out that dissatisfied people, it was a sense of disgust the way it was done. Yeah. And so I think, Jim, right now, and now that has been compounded, if anything, or at least complicated, by the way the speech was scheduled.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about
the back and forth on that. I mean, you know, kind of a clever gotcha in the White House. Hey, we'll do it on the 7th because that's the night that they're going to be debating at the Reagan Library. The Republican candidates will step on their story, thinks somebody. And, you know, it was just, for whatever reason. And then John Boehner, having been presented with this opportunity where he could look big, if anything, starts to the amazing shrinking man, becomes the first speaker in House to deny a request to speak. So they both come out looking smaller as a result of that back and forth.
You see it the same way?
I agree. I mean, if we're going out to lunch, I call you up and say what day is good, and then we juggle dates and we find a date.
They've always done it, isn't it?
Yeah, but I'm sure, you know, again, people are really angry. And so the Democrats saw a chance to step all over the debate, and the Republicans saw a chance to step all over the Democrats, so they took their chances. But everyone else thinks, well, you know, what are you doing? What are you doing?
Because I've read a lot about this. We all have, that there is no precedent for, first of all, a president calling a joint session of Congress without talking to the people who run the Congress, whether or not, what the date, let's do this and this. And apparently, the Obama White House did not do that. Is that right?
It's very hard to parse. People have different claims, but that seems to be the essential truth.
Yeah, they say that they did. They say that they did talk to the Speaker's office and there was an agreement, but then the Speaker said, well, there wasn't a specific date. So general agreement, but not a specific arrangement, it seems to be. But you're right. I mean, the net product for people was to say, my God almighty, are these people, they're the Bickersons, they're the petty. It's like that couple you don't want to be around, you know, constantly. Did you see what he did? Yeah. You know, isn't she terrible?
And for the White House, they have to understand how bad this month has been. This period has really been bad. Mark mentioned the faith in government. Yeah. Now, Obama wanted to restore faith in government. Now we're again at historic lows. And then Obama's ratings himself have plummeted. Dropped significantly this past month, and part of just the whole atmosphere. So Americans are just not going to tune in that much until Election Day. He's got a few moments to make people say, oh, that's different. And I know they're looking for that moment, this may be that moment. Even this will be tough. He doesn't have much time. He's got between 8 and the time the football game starts. A little
seven.
Time left.
I'm going to do it at 7.
Okay. 7.
So he's
going to
do it at
yeah.
7.
Do you agree with Mark that both sides look terrible on this? I mean, this was a terrible thing for the way the White House did it, as also that Boehner also violating precedent the way he did. It looks smaller as well.
Yeah, well, people will just say, as they've said in the debt ceiling debate, as they've said a zillion times, those people in Washington don't play by the normal rules we play mm-hmm. by.
Yeah. Well, there's another thing, of course, that came up this recently was Eric Cantor, the House Majority Leader, raised the issue about set-aside, which on hurricane relief, disaster relief, that if you're going to, we're going to give money to the victims of hurricanes, well, we got to cut the budget somewhere else in order to give them the money. And he's brought a lot of people down on him about it. What do you think about that?
Well, it's a new position for Eric Cantor, because in 2004, when the tropical storm, hurricane-turned-tropical storm Gaston, hit central Virginia and dumped 12 inches of rain in 10 hours, the first person to request disaster relief was Congressman Eric Cantor for his. They came up with $20 million. And when Jeb Hensarling of Texas, a Republican member, said, no, we've got to do this, we've got to have set-asides for this, Eric Cantor was one of 127 Republicans in the House who voted against Jeb Hensarling. He said, no, time of emergency, you have to come up with it. Yes, he's right in the abstract. That
you got to pay for everything.
You got to pay for everything.
Yeah.
We have wars in Iraq and Afghanistan which have gone unpaid for. We have all sorts of tax deals for the very best right. off in the country that have gone unpaid for in our off budget. Why start with this. People who have knocked out of their homes in Connecticut, in New Jersey, and Vermont? Yeah. I guess because they're blue states.
Yeah. What do you think?
They should put a poster up in Congress to show the difference between a million, a billion, and a trillion. Our problems are in trillions. And to argue about millions, it's pointless. So it's a problem of scale here. We do this all the time. We think, we'll cut pay for congressmen and we'll solve the budget deficit. We'll cut pay for foreign aid and we'll solve the budget deficit. No, that's trillions. These are millions. It doesn't really matter. So it's senseless to fight about the things which are legitimate government spending on storm reparations, and when the real problems are in the trillions.
David's right. And it was something we did very well. I mean, the government did at every level. I mean, the states did it well, locals did it well, and the feds did it well in this storm.
And nobody questions their responsibility to
no.
do it.
No.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Thank
well,
you.
Ron Paul.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.